a bit hungover.
I think I will have to edit that.
Over 80% of the people around don't enjoy their work.
Get a good education, stable job, and raise a family.
I slept on a futon until I was 36. I don't fucking regret any of it.
I just wanted to have some type of impact, didn't matter what it was.
Welcome to 99 Career Options Podcast, session number one. Today we are talking with a dear friend of mine, Chris Starkey. Chris is a commercial lawyer at Clifford Chance in London, but he also talks and walks engineering, and he worked as a structural engineer in Sydney for a couple of years. He hopes to become the new Steve Jobs and the Prime Minister of Australia. All links and resources are in the show notes at 99careeroptions.com/1, and you can say hi on Twitter and Facebook using the same name. But now, let's go and chat with Chris. What do you think about it?
Yeah, it's a great idea. I mean, I think especially with the teenagers, like, I remember living in coming from a small town that had very little diversity in the kind of jobs that people had, and then going to school in a smaller city which had similar kind of limitations on what other people did, and so what influences I had, and teachers would encourage you for certain types of careers which were just really safe, and they were really kind of predictable, and you could go and do a degree and you'd end up doing something really unimaginative. And so I didn't really have any, like, my aspirations for the future were just very, very unexciting and very ordinary. And I mean, I ended up choosing something that I think probably was well suited to me. But I didn't feel like I had that many options, to be honest. It was a choice between either things that were quite boring but seemed sensible, or things that were completely fanciful, like being a rock star or a movie star or stuff like that. Like, it was those two ends of the spectrum. But I think that this kind of resource would be really helpful. And I mean, would have been helpful for me, even though, like, I hardly think that what I do is the kind of thing that's going to get a 17-year-old really, you know, super excited. I still think, you know, getting the exposure to the way people go through their careers, like, it not only was it there, you know, I guess pressure to do something safe and predictable, but there was also a pressure to do it immediately and figure it out straight away. And, you know, I remember like lots of people's parents, like, just reinforcing this idea that if you don't, like, do really well in these exams now, you're going to ruin the rest of your life, and if you don't get into the right university now, that's it for your career, and all this kind of stuff, which was just totally untrue. And, you know, like, even the tradition of a gap year that they have in the UK, we don't have. It's considered to be unusual when I think for people that are going to go to university and that kind of stuff, and a lot of people do go to university. I don't know the statistics, but it's not by any means out of reach. So anyone that does reasonably well at school, like, if you're in the top 40% of people in academically, you'll go to university, or at least you can. And anyway, so thinking about going to university and what you're going to do with the rest of your career, you either go to university straight after high school, or you do what everyone calls deferring. And that's the term that's used. You defer your degree. And that has a, like, it's like a, that's a bad word. If you hear talking about, I'm thinking of deferring, everyone will be like, oh shit, like, whoa, don't do that, because you'll go off the rails, and, like, you'll never go back to university, and you'll end up as some kind of, you know, street cleaner or that kind of thing. So there's, like, I know here in the UK, like, going on a gap year is considered to be, like, one of the formative experiences in your life. And I know that, like, I've met people in Europe who talk about just doing different things after they finish, like maybe to go and volunteer or do something and that kind of stuff. And that's totally, well, at least, I don't know, I finished high school 15 years ago almost. So that's a long time ago. That's a long enough time that things might have changed. But that's what it was like then. And maybe there would be a bit of difference in the bigger cities. And there's probably a bigger difference too with people from, like, people from backgrounds that are very affluent have a lot of opportunity, because I suppose there's probably this attitude that whatever they do, they're always going to be fine anyway, so there's not as much pressure. But I think in the kind of general middle class, that's the typical experience.
Got it. So if we try to structure things a little bit, do you wanna tell the listeners what do you do and what did you study?
So what I do now is I'm a commercial lawyer. In order for me to become a commercial lawyer, I studied law, but I had not a very direct path to get here. When I finished high school, I studied engineering. I did civil engineering, and then I graduated and worked for a couple of years in Sydney as a structural engineer, working on designing, you know, office buildings and warehouses and hotels and that type of thing. And then I decided that I didn't want to do that anymore, and I re-enrolled in university in Sydney and did a law degree with a bunch of other people in a similar kind of situation. So instead of studying with people straight from high school, I studied with a group of other graduates.
Okay, that's interesting. Maybe this is a silly question, but what does a commercial lawyer do?
Okay, so there's, being a lawyer can mean a lot of different things. I think for people that aren't familiar with the law, when they think of what it is to be a lawyer, they probably think of someone in a courtroom arguing in front of a judge, probably about a murder or something like that. So even that description I've given, there are two very specific things about what that type of lawyer is that sets it apart from other kinds of lawyers. Firstly, they're a litigator. Litigation is that process of arguing with another party in front of a judge to resolve some kind of dispute. And the second aspect of that example is that it's criminal law. So it's not only is it some kind of dispute, but the dispute is specifically between the state or the government and an individual. And they're, as we all know, claiming that the individual has broken some law and they're trying to prosecute them. But that is a very, very specific type of law. And only relatively speaking, very few lawyers actually do that type of work. What I do is almost at the other end of the spectrum.
So how many types of lawyer will you have?
Well, so so there's litigation, and then there's anything that's not litigation for starters, and anything that's not litigation which is anything outside of a courtroom, that can be like a general family lawyer that has an office in the suburbs and might help you with your will or you know, doing some property work or giving you some advice on your taxes. It can be a specialized family lawyer who helps people getting divorces and, you know, custody of children, that kind of thing. There are people that specialize in medical malpractice. So these people would also be a type of litigator, someone that sues some doctor for failing to take, you know, the proper care with a patient. General litigation, like in the non-criminal aspect, which you might sue a company for selling you a product that caused you harm. You might sue a neighbor for damaging your house in some way. So, you know, just the general, you know, legal, like courtroom kind of law. And then what I do as a commercial lawyer and a non-litigation commercial lawyer is I basically advise businesses to help them do their business. Most of the time, what that involves is helping businesses prepare the contracts that they will use to make their money. So in particular, I work in the field of infrastructure development. So I work with businesses that want to build a hospital for on behalf of the government, or they want to build a power station and sell the power to a government, or they might want to build my client might be a government and they might be building a freeway or something like that. And the contracts that I help them prepare are the contracts with, say, the builder who's going to do the construction, or it might be someone who's going to then operate whatever this piece of infrastructure is on behalf of the government or whomever. So that's what I do.
Okay. So if we go back to your studies, when you decided to be an engineer, why did you decide to be an engineer? Did you have any influences?
Basically, I had wanted to be a doctor for a very long time. My father was a doctor, and I had a close family friend who was a very inspirational neurosurgeon who's actually now quite famous in Australia and a bit of a renegade. And I'd always thought that that's what I wanted to do. And then when I was about 17 and starting to do dissections in science class, I realized that I absolutely did not want to do that, that it was gross and disgusting. And if I had to spend any amount of time cutting up bodies live or dead, then I was just, no way was I going to sign up for that kind of thing. So that happened shortly before I had to kind of make my decisions about what I was going to do, because in Australia, you kind of have to make those decisions when you're in your second last year of school. So I was kind of panicking, I think, a bit. I had put all my eggs in that basket for, 4 or 5 years, and now I didn't know what to do. So I went to a university open day at the university that I actually ended up studying at, called the University of Wollongong. And I had chosen all these different faculties to go and listen to them speak. I think I definitely did not go to law, because I thought I was not interested in that at all at that point. I think I went and looked at maybe like communications and technology or some arts, just because I thought maybe that would be interesting. But the first one that I went to was engineering, and I sat down and I was pretty sure that I didn't want to be an engineer because I thought it just looked a bit dull. But then the guy speaking, he just started listing or describing all of these things that immediately resonated with me. So it talked about, working as a team, problem solving, relying on, your rational decision making and logic, and relating it to like solving puzzles and all these kind of things, which I really enjoyed and really sounded appealing. And so after 1 hour of listening to this guy, I was sold completely. I thought, well, there's no point going to any more of these lectures because I want to be an engineer, and that's what happened.
And how was the studying period?
The studying was, from an academic point of view, it was really exciting because, generally speaking, you're surrounded by really smart people who are interested in the same kind of things as you. So you get to feel really validated, I think, instead of being one person out of, 100 or something that likes a certain thing, you're surrounded by 100 people who like exactly the same thing. So it's a really good feeling to be in that environment and not to feel, like any reason to be ashamed of talking about, science and maths in an excited way. And it definitely changes you, the study. People used to say, at least when I was at school, that it's not so much what you learn when you're at university, it's how it teaches you to think, which is the most important thing. And I know that because I know that's true, because when I finished my engineering degree, I was definitely quite different as in my personality, in the way that I thought and solved problems and looked at situations, than when I was before I went to university. And when I finished my law degree, I was different again from how I was as an engineer. So it just those few years, they have a really powerful effect on how you think and how you look at the world and how you solve problems, how you engage in conversation and all that kind of stuff.
When did you realize that you want to do something else?
Well, I always enjoyed studying engineering, even though I wasn't a particularly good student. I didn't study very hard, but I enjoyed all of the classes and I enjoyed applying myself to those types of problems. And so the whole way through, even to the end, I was really interested. I think in the final year, we had to do some kind of project where we, you know, tried to design a bridge and we had to do all these presentations and I was really into it. And I thought for sure that I was going to, be an engineer forever. And, I remember graduating and my dad saying, you know, this is going to be the first of 3 or 4 different degrees that you're going to do and different careers you're going to have. And it really annoyed me that he would say that. I'd be like, you don't know what you're talking about. Why I like this. I'm good at this. So, you know, just shut up. But then almost as soon as I started working as an engineer, I realized that I hated it. I was just pretty much instantly bored.
Why?
And I had this feeling like, you, Callan, I know you're an active guy. You like exercising. It's kind of the feeling like, if instead of being able to exercise, like go swimming in a swimming pool, all you could do was stick one leg in the water and kick one foot. That's kind of how it felt mentally for me, that I had all of my brain that I wanted to kind of to use, but there was only this tiny little part of it that was actually getting any exercise. And I was struggling with that for a while. I was really bored and, I was looking at the guys that I was working with and I was thinking, no offense, lovely guys, but how boring they kind of were and the lives that they lived and the conversations that they had and all this type of stuff. And I thought, what am I doing? This is not the world that I want to be a part of. I don't want to be an engineer exactly. Well, at least I didn't want to be that kind of engineer. So I realized I had to do something different. I didn't know what I wanted it to be. And then I had this big life-changing event where the girl that I'd been dating and who I'd been engaged to for like 6 or 7 years, she ended our relationship. And so my whole world was in this total tailspin. And I realized I was in this kind of frame of mind where I was ready to fuck it all up, just like make as big a mess of my life as possible, basically, because I thought, what does it all matter? What are the consequences? My life is already ruined. So I was thinking of maybe just like quitting and flying to America and trying to get a job there, or maybe seeing if I could be a management consultant. But ultimately, I decided to go back to university because I just wanted to almost like restart things. I kind of go back to how it was when I was 18 and I had everything in front of me and kind of erase, I guess, the 6 years previously and just start again, which is what I did. And that was basically it. I thought law was interesting. I had really enjoyed conversations that I'd had with my friends who had been studying law, and I'd always been interested in politics and government and that kind of stuff. So I thought, well, hey, that's kind of interesting, and university was fun. So
exactly. Did you have any mentor? Was it someone that advised you to go to law?
Well, in fact, I had the opposite. I had no one encouraging me whatsoever. The people that had studied law, they thought I was crazy. They're like, why would you do that? No, don't. It's really hard. It's really competitive. It's, you know, it's stressful. Everyone that I know hates their job. So they weren't painting the rosiest picture. But I think the way that I've tended to make decisions in my life has been that I think of something and I just have this feeling that it's the right thing to do. And I'll think about things a lot and nothing will feel right. And then all of a sudden there'll just be like an epiphany and I kind of lock that in. And then in spite of what people say, I kind of ignore them. And I'm like, no, I know what this is. And rightly or wrongly, that's kind of how I make these decisions about my life. So with the law, my dad thought I was insane to kind of throw away this very, you know, comfortable and secure career as an engineer. My law friends or friends at Dunmore, they thought it was stupid. I think my sister and my brother, they were a bit concerned that I was making this decision, like in this state where I was still, like, you know, getting over a breakup and all that kind of stuff. But it just, I just knew that it was going to be the right thing. And I think, like, that has tended to work out for me. So I'm kind of going on my track record of not doing anything too stupid.
So I guess it was the right thing, looking back right now.
Definitely. It's the best decision that I ever made, easily. I think up until that point, I'd felt like I was doing things because they made sense, like
in a social context.
Kind of, yeah. Like I was following the rule book properly. Like even when I studied engineering, I know I said that like this guy was saying things that really resonated with me, but they were still resonating in a way that was like ticking boxes on a checklist. Like, you know, that was, I knew that I had to be moving in a certain direction because that's how everyone was kind of making me feel. And that's how that decision was kind of fitting in with all that. Whereas when I decided to do law, it was quite the opposite. I was really kind of destroying a lot of, well, felt like I might have been destroying a lot of the groundwork that I'd already, you know, carried out. And this was something that was purely personal. It was not being pressured by anybody else. It was not based on anybody's advice. So it's something that I could really take ownership of, and it changed my life completely. Like it changed, I made amazing friends, not only through my studies, but also as a lawyer through working as a lawyer. It made me more confident. It exposed me to, you know, thinking about the world in a way where you're in control and these institutions and, you know, authority and rules and the law and stuff like that is something that, you know, can be navigated instead of something that's just out there to keep you controlled. It changed the way that I thought of what my options were for the rest of my life and what I should expect from life and how I should expect other people to treat me. And I don't know, it was a really good decision. Definitely one of the few decisions that I think that I've made that has had no downside.
How was the studying period?
It was...
And also, if you compare that with the engineering.
Yeah, it's interesting. It was very, very different. I was initially really intimidated because although there are certain ways of thinking as a lawyer which are similar to being an engineer, which is being able to, you know, extract from a situation what are the key problems and then applying the rules that you've learned to solving those problems or answering a particular question. The way that you express your understanding and the way that you provide answers is completely different. So whereas as an engineer relies on basically maths to solve problems and, you know, mathematic language and mathematic problem solving, a lawyer relies on words. Words are a lawyer's tools. And for someone that had, you know, wasn't ever really super strong at English and at school, and then who had then spent 6 years studying or working as an engineer, being expected to string a sentence together was, you know, a pretty intimidating task, let alone, you know, write 5,000 word essays. So it was really intimidating. And initially I thought that I wasn't going to do so well. And on top of that, it was just a totally different learning structure. Whereas in engineering, you'd have a lecture which would present, you know, it would be like a new topic, let's say in mechanics, you know, fluid mechanics, would say, here's a new equation that you're going to learn. It describes the way that water will behave in certain type of, you know, environment. this is the equation that take you through how the equation worked and what the first principles were. And then later in the week, you'd have a tutorial. You'd go through and do examples of that. You'd have these like regular assignments to keep you on board. And although the concepts, the underlying concepts were probably more difficult to learn, the actual study of it seemed like far easier. Whereas the law, you know, what people are describing and it really all it is, you know, human behavior and social interaction and just creating rules to govern that. It's quite a lot more. Well, the difference is that there's nothing clear cut about it. And for the reason that it's just about, you know, social organizing and human behavior. Whereas in engineering, things are quite prescriptive. Here's the equation. So long as you can understand the fundamentals of that equation, so long as you can use it, so long as you can identify when it applies, then you're okay. And there's one right answer and every other answer is wrong. In law, they might tell you that there's one right answer, but it's not clear cut. There's no equation. There's no set of equation, you know, formula that you can just apply instantly and show out the working and then you're good. And so it gives you a much stronger feeling of doubt and unease that you're understanding things. It's harder to know when you're getting things right. So even though it was engaging and it was interesting, I think my experience studying law was much more stressful than it was studying engineering.
Okay. For how many years did you study law?
Law was 3 degree. Engineering was 4 years.
That's a lot of studying. It's quite. Actually, I do know a little bit about not being able to speak the language, just because I'm doing this podcast and I'm talking with a lot of people, right? That speak English, I also speak English, but that they have English as the first language. So all the time when I'm listening to the podcast, right, and I'm editing, right, I'm hearing the way I'm mumbling, right, I'm not pronunciating. So now I'm trying quite hard, right, also to improve the way I talk and so on and so forth. So I
that must be awful to have to listen to yourself.
Yeah, yeah, it is. It is.
Yeah, so, I hate the sound of my own voice.
Yeah, yeah. So that's why usually I try not to speak that much, but also it can be really awkward, right? Mm. Because it's quite awkward just to ask question, right, to someone. Like it's much more fun to engage somehow. But to go back to you after you finish law, what were the job prospects? What could you work at?
Well, it's notoriously competitive, studying as a lawyer and then trying to break into working as a lawyer. Most of the jobs that are out there relate to the business world, and basically different sorts of commercial law, and the kind of the big ticket graduate positions were, you know, the highly paid like graduate programs in these large commercial law firms. And so that's what in the university that I went to, I think that's what most people were aiming towards, but it was quite competitive. There were a few people that were interested in doing more, I suppose, noble is the way you can describe it, and less, you know, money-driven careers, which were working for, you know, non-profit organizations providing legal aid or other types of things like legal advice for, you know, Aboriginal communities and land rights claims and those types of things. But they were even more competitive. So it was... You know, it wasn't like when I graduated engineering, for instance, it was before the financial crisis, the economy was booming and engineers were always in high demand. So everyone kind of graduated knowing that they were going to get a job and it was going to pay pretty well and you were going to be pretty well set. Whereas in law, there was a lot more uncertainty And I was fortunate compared to my peers because I did have this background in engineering, and that's what set me apart. And so although I didn't have like the top marks, I had something that set me apart. So if I'd done law straight out of school, and if I'd performed the same academically, which wasn't bad, but I wasn't a shining star, I probably wouldn't have ended up with the opportunities that I did. So it was the smarter way to do it from the point of view of, you know, having a lucrative career, was to do it exactly the way I did, which was kind of funny because it was a total accident. And, you know, I thought that I was probably going to end up feeling like I was behind the curve because I was a few years older than everybody. But I was fortunate enough to be working with the daughter of a partner at a very good law firm while I was, you know, working as a waiter in Sydney. And I was starting to freak out because I hadn't really had anything lined up. I was unable to get a position in the internship programs that the big firms would run in the, you know, second last summer before you finished, or the last summer rather before you finished. So I thought that I was kind of like clutching at straws. But this girl, she told me that her mum worked in a construction law group in a commercial law firm, and that they were desperately in need of new people because they had a lot of people leave. And she invited me to pass on my details, which is what I did. And the, you know, rest is history. But I know other people who performed in exactly the same level academically as I did, and who just as smart and just as presentable and able to, you know, carry themselves in an interview and come across as an interesting and an intelligent person. And they had a lot of difficulty, and they had to, in many cases, take jobs that they weren't really happy with or weren't happy with at all. But, you know, in all of those cases, they eventually were able to take that early experience, even though it wasn't satisfactory, and use that to leverage a better job later. After a lot of despair and negative feelings about it, they all ended up doing what they're more or less happy doing.
Yeah. So how does a day at work look like?
Well, sometimes it looks like me arriving a bit hungover.
I think I'll have to edit that.
it involves basically, my days are fairly predictable, I'd say. There's not a huge amount of variety from one day to another. I work in an office building in a part of London called Canary Wharf, which is really a kind of financial center. I share an office with another lawyer who's about my age and at the same level as me. I arrive between 8:30 and 10 o'clock, and I will sit at my computer. I will be reviewing contracts or drafting contracts or on the phone to people discussing contracts. You know, from time to time, I will go to meetings to negotiate contracts, but mainly I negotiate the contracts either over the phone or via email. I will engage in witty banter with my colleagues, have asked questions to my partners about, you know, parts of the law which I need assistance on, and then generally work until between 7 and 10 p.m. That's around there, and then leave. That's the day.
Okay. So does it look like suits? You know, like the movie suits?
It does look a lot. I mean, okay. People people dress nicely, probably not as nicely as they did on the TV show. The building is a big glass and steel concrete tower. You know, you walk on the streets and everyone looks very serious and wears their, you know, suits, and in winter their, you know, nice coats, and like, you know, is looking around at everybody else, you know, with a scowl because they're busy and they've got to get somewhere. But there's definitely less action in the life of a typical commercial lawyer than there is in Suits. You spend way more time in the office. You spend way more time working on the detail rather than kind of solving the big picture problems, because that's kind of what being a lawyer is all about, is the detail. Most of the work that you do is devoted to making sure you haven't missed something, making sure that the I's are dotted and the T's are crossed, and that, you know, ultimately you're acting for a client, you're presenting your client's best interests, or trying to secure your client's best interests. So what that means is making sure nothing is slipping between the cracks, and that it's all about risk assessment. And you're asking yourself, well, what if this is happening? What's the consequence going to be? And how do I make sure that the contract protects my clients in that scenario?
Got it. What do you love about your job right now?
I love the intellectual challenge. It's you can feel your brain working hard, and sometimes it can be exhausting, but it's a great feeling to know that you're kind of, it sounds a bit lame, but meeting your potential in a way, that you're kind of working at the level that you can, instead of, I think, what I felt when I was an engineer is, as I said, because I wasn't, you know, exercising all of my mind or only a small part of it, that still applies. I mean, you can't ever be engaged 100% of your brain, because there's different parts that do different things, but there's more engagement. So I like feeling stimulated like that. And I do like feeling that, I like feeling that I'm involved in, like, things that matter in a way. So I like feeling that even though I only play a small part, I am partially responsible for this new power station that's being built in West Africa. I'm partially responsible for this new hospital that's being built in Turkey. I'm partially responsible for the offshore wind farm that's being built in, you know, in off the coast of Britain. And that's a good feeling, to know that what it is you're doing matters somehow.
You almost make me go and apply for law tomorrow.
I'm surprised that it sounds so appealing, because you're just talking about the things that I love, Colin. It's not the complete picture.
Yeah, but I totally feel sometimes that I just don't use my brain the way I can use it, right? Mm. And all the time you just need to do some tasks that anyone else could do it, and they can even automate it somehow, right?
Mm. Mm. Yeah. That was a lot of the feeling that I had as an engineer. I felt a bit like a fucking monkey could do this, because not that a monkey can be an engineer, and I don't want anyone to think that I don't respect engineers, because I respect engineers enormously. It just wasn't for me. But I would often be sitting there and I'd be using this computer software to refine a particular, you know, model to optimize it somehow. And I just think, like, I've done 4 years of university. Why am I doing this? This just feels so basic. And I definitely feel like that sometimes as a lawyer. And when you're a junior lawyer, especially, you've got to do a lot of proofreading and that kind of stuff, and that's pretty boring. But mainly I feel like I you know, I'm utilizing my education and I'm utilizing my abilities.
Didn't you ever had doubts when you started law, those 3 years?
Mm. I had doubts about whether I wanted to be a lawyer. In fact, I think the whole way through, I just assumed that I wasn't going to be a lawyer. I wasn't thinking about it. I thought that that was a problem that I was going to solve when I finished the degree. But I knew that I was enjoying the degree enough, and I was enjoying, to be completely honest, the thing that I was enjoying the most was the social aspect, because what I described about the experience of being around people who were the same as you, that applied much, much more to my experience studying law than it did to my experience studying as engineering. So this was really kind of where I came into myself socially, and developed a lot of my confidence. And I was kind of drunk on that feeling of being, of not being the same, but being part of a group of people that I felt like I shared so much with. And that, even though I was enjoying that, and I was continuing to be in that environment because I was enjoying that, it was also encouraging to me that, well, I feel like I'm like all these people, and these people are all doing this degree. So therefore, surely there's a reason why we're all so similar and we're all doing the same thing, and it must be a good reason. So I wasn't really questioning it that much at that point. I think, in fact, I thought that I was probably going to finish law and then maybe do something like, management consulting or something like that. Or, I was having these fantasies of doing like international trade law or something like that, working as part of the World Trade Organization and that kind of thing. But ultimately I ended up doing commercial law instead.
If you could go back in time, would you change something?
I would probably have tried a bit harder when I was kind of coming to the end of my degree to seek out different opportunities, I think, that I could use my degree for. Like this, for example, the international trade law. I think it would have been, even if I ultimately had ended up doing what I'm doing now, I think it would have just been fascinating. And that could have been an opportunity. And basically I didn't do it because I didn't think that I would have ever been selected. And I thought, I had this kind of attitude back then that those type of things were, they were for other people. Other people would get selected and I would never get selected. But in hindsight, I think that was just a lack of confidence, and that anybody can do anything. No one is the type of person that things never happen to or that never gets selected. If you want something, then you've got to put your hand up. No one's ever going to just give it to you, and you've got to put in a bit of effort. So that's probably what I'd change. Not be so happy to cruise and wait for things to happen to me.
Got it. Who are your heroes?
Yeah. Who are my heroes? I don't really have any heroes. I don't spend that much time looking at other people and how they've lived their life and comparing it to my own. Or I don't spend that much time drawing inspiration from people in terms of what it is to be a good person. There are people that I admire and I really admire. I mean, this is pretty cliche, but I admire Steve Jobs an enormous amount. I think, he was just he was a real visionary, and in spite of, his lack of technical ability, and he may not have been a creative genius any sense, but he understood the way that people worked, and he understood like what people were capable of and what he was capable of, and he really pushed it in a very inspiring way. And I also currently, someone who's a bit more relevant, I admire, this is a bit embarrassing if anyone knows who this, but I admire the current Australian Prime Minister, Malcolm Turnbull. He's a really, really smart guy, and he's had a career which I would quite like to emulate at some point. He was a lawyer originally. He became a barrister, so a litigator, after working worked for Channel 9, so a media company in Australia, with a big famous businessman, Kerry Packer, at its head. And he then became a barrister, and he was involved in a very high-profile case where he defended a former English spy against the English government, who were trying to stop this spy from releasing his memoirs. And then he left law and he became a businessman, and he owned one of the first Australian ISPs when the internet was starting out, made a lot of money. And then he became the head of the Australian Republican movement in the late 90s. And then ultimately in the kind of about 10 years ago or so, he became a politician. And eventually he became prime minister. So he's had a really, really interesting career. He's obviously a very driven person, but he also seems to be, notwithstanding that he's probably a narcissist, as a lot of very accomplished people are, he does seem to be a good person, and he has, you know, he's quite compassionate, and he has a lot of empathy, and he doesn't have that kind of selfishness that a lot of very successful people have.
Okay, I definitely need to Google him up now. What life lesson did you learn the hard way?
I think that everything that you're going through, other people are going through as well, have gone through as well. That nothing really that happens to you, you're not alone, and you're not the first person or the only person that it's happened to. And I think I learned that after, I've had a few bad things happen to me when I was younger. I had my mum died when I was 13. She had leukemia. And then I wasn't that much older when I started dating my high school girlfriend. And I think in hindsight, a lot of the reason why I got so involved in that was this kind of self-pity that I felt about losing my mother, and, you know, looking for a way for someone to kind of make that better, because I had this feeling that, you know, like I've had this huge thing that's happened in my life, which is unique, and that other people wouldn't be able to understand and all that kind of stuff. And then when eventually that ended much later, and I had that same feeling again of, you know, life dealing me this cruel blow and no one being able to understand how I could be feeling, and look at my life, I've suffered so many, you know, misfortunes. And I eventually, after experiencing that and getting to the other side after a long time, was able to look back and look at what I'd gone through, and then look at all of these other people that I'd met that had gone through the same thing, that had lost a parent, or that had, you know, been dumped after a long relationship, and just realized how ordinary and completely unremarkable my experiences were. And the reason why that's a lesson is because I think that it's very easy when you are going through something that's difficult to lose sight of the big picture, to think that, you know, there is something special about you in a bad way, like you're marked for misery or for failure or for something like that. And that's not true, and that everyone goes through hardship of some kind, and, you know, normally people get out of it and overcome it. And so if you if you give up and if you despair, then if you indulge those feelings of self-pity and you know, some kind of destiny, then you're probably going to end up miserable and you're not going to handle it. Whereas if you keep your perspective and you realize that it's something that happens to other people and that you're not alone and that other people have dealt with whatever you're dealing with and they've made it through it and they've been okay, then you'll probably be okay too.
So I guess that in the end is just the story that you're telling yourself, right?
Yeah.
So you can tell you all these stories, right? You can tell, oh, poor me, or you can just actually see that it's so common, right?
Yeah, exactly.
We are almost at the end, just a couple of questions more. If you can recommend some resources, if someone wants to choose this path, some books, podcasts, or movies that they can read or watch, they can learn more about it, some internet pages, some blogs.
About being a lawyer. Well, to be honest, even though a lot of the, you know, TV and movies that you watch are sensationalized, they still do present a fairly, it's not too inaccurate. Like, it's based in truth. And so if you do respond well to, you know, that sensationalized version of the law, then you're probably going to get a decent insight. I think there's a movie called Michael Clayton, which is a really good movie, and it doesn't paint the rosiest picture of being a commercial lawyer, but it's quite gripping and it's quite accurate. In terms of like more realistic resources about getting an understanding of what it's like as a lawyer, there are. If you're a student, then I think there are law societies in all universities that are more kind of focused on the experiences of students themselves, but they're always very interested in and very enthusiastic about talking about what they do and about creating opportunities for people to learn more about the faculties and learn more about the student life and all that kind of stuff. So I think they're a good resource. In the UK, more specifically, there's a website called Roll On Friday, which is really completely devoted to the experiences of young corporate lawyers. It's really more of a kind of like a gossip website, if anything else, and talking about what the various firms are doing, complaining about this and that. But that's the most authentic, I think, insight you could get into the mind of the type of person that does my job.
Got it. How do you see the future of this type of job?
It's interesting. I think the legal profession is changing quite a lot. For starters, a lot of things, the globalization is definitely having an impact. Like things are starting to be outsourced. I know certain firms that are outsourcing like paralegal work to, you know, India and places like that to cut costs. I know that things are becoming automated or not automated per se, but things that you used to need a lawyer to do, you can now kind of do yourself through, you know, online packages and templates and that kind of thing. And there are ways that you can avoid using lawyers at all, which, I mean, I think it's a good thing. But for the industry, it means that what we provide, the service we provide is becoming replaceable. So lawyers are faced with the challenge of demonstrating the value that they provide to consumers and how that, in an ongoing basis, how they stay relevant. So I think the effect that it has, firstly, I mean, I want to say that it might reduce the amount of demand for lawyers, but at the same time, I think lawyers are kind of clever and they will find ways to create more demand for their services. So maybe it, like, expand the scope of what they do and create an illusion maybe of necessary when maybe they aren't necessary. But I think also corporatizing law firms is becoming something. Instead of law firms being run by partners, instead they're kind of being owned by shareholders and being run as companies instead of partnerships. The old-fashioned way of charging just per hour is changing. People, clients are expecting more predictability about fees and expecting flat rates and that kind of stuff. So I think with these changes, the general trend is that the law is going to become more I'm a commercial lawyer, so I'm providing legal advice all the time. But the way that law firms tend to be run tends to be very uncommercial and old-fashioned. And there are certain, like, inefficiencies, and management's quite loose and this type of stuff. And I think that's the thing that's going to change, is that it's going to become more corporatized in an internal way, that there'll become an increasing focus on, like, KPIs and performance management and management structures and like more financial accountability and more focus on efficiency and that kind of stuff. So I think it'll change what being a lawyer is from purely being just someone that gives advice, legal advice, to someone that has more of a, I think maybe more of a management role, and that's kind of built into being a lawyer from the early days and the trajectory of being a lawyer. I mean, it's already changed in the last 10 years. I think 10 years ago, or certainly 20 years ago, people would expect to be a partner of a law firm in less than 10 years. Even 5 years wouldn't be that unusual. Whereas now, you know, 10 years is the minimum, really, especially in a large firm that you'd expect.
Really? Okay. Is any particular skill really good to have if you want to be a lawyer?
I think the most important skill is having a questioning mind, being unsatisfied with an answer because someone simply told you what the answer is, and wanting to know the deeper truth and certainty. And you can tell people that have that curiosity from, you know, they don't need to be lawyers for you to be able to identify that. You meet people, and, you know, young people, students, and people that aren't lawyers, and you can have a conversation and you can tell the way they ask questions and they're not satisfied with the answers and they keep pressing you for, how do you know that? Why do you know that? So that's really important. And also being able to distinguish, like having an ability to see the difference between things that are very similar. I think that's one of the cornerstones of being a lawyer. And in fact, it's one of the things that people hate about lawyers the most, because, you know, people will say, you know, you're saying that this and this is the same thing when it's two different things, when it's obviously the same thing. You're lying, you know. You said this then and now you're saying this now, but how can that be different? And, well, maybe it seems like the same thing to a non-lawyer, and it's frustrating to hear people make those types of arguments, but you need to be able to do that to be a good lawyer, because that's what it's all about at the end of the day, is identifying the subtle distinctions between things. That's how you argue in a courtroom. That's how you negotiate a contract.
Got it. If the listeners are interested to know more about this career path and maybe some other steps that you took, would you agree to do a webinar?
Yeah, okay, sure.
Cool. So in closing, what would be your advice for someone choosing a career path? And it can be this
any
one
career path, or choosing my career path.
Let's say choosing your career path, but also any career path.
Someone that's choosing my career path, I would say I think you need to, firstly, keep an open mind about what you expect from both the degree and then the career, because I think that, like everything, you don't know what it's going to be like, and you don't know where the education or the career is going to take you, even a year after you make that decision and start on the road. So I think if you make your mind up too quickly, you might close yourself off to opportunities that could be, you know, really exciting and work out really well for you. And I suppose that's the kind of advice that I'd give anyone choosing any career path, actually, is that you might think you've got things all figured out quickly, but that's because you don't know what else is out there. The most interesting people that I know, they aren't doing what they thought they'd be doing 10 years ago. And they did degrees that ultimately have nothing to do with what they're doing now. And that doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if you change. It doesn't matter if you do a degree and then change halfway through. It doesn't matter if you do a degree and then do another degree later. That's different. I mean, none of this time is time wasted. You're always learning something. And as long as you just keep working towards some goal, whatever it is, then I think eventually you're going to end up doing something that makes you happy.
Very, very good advice. Wonderful, Chris. I really enjoyed the conversation. I'll put all the recommendations and everything that we talked about in the show notes, and thank you so much for your time.
You're welcome, Colleen. Thank you.
So guys, if you want to learn what steps took Chris to land his first job and how he managed to stand by his choice when everyone around him told him that he is crazy, or whatever question you might have, please visit 99careeroptions.com/01 and join the webinar so you can ask whatever questions you might have yourself. Yes, you will be the interviewer instead of me. Before you leave, it will mean the world for me if you can leave a review and share my work with people that would find it useful. Maybe it is a brother, a sister, a friend or a niece, someone choosing a career path. Thank you so much for listening, guys. You are awesome. Don't forget that you can be whatever you want to be as long as you know your options. You are the reason and hopefully the support for these interviews, so please send me feedback and advice if you want me to change something, add some questions in my interviews, or interview someone with a particular job that you are interested in. See you later.